Now I am become death, the destroyer of worlds. These words, taken from the ancient Hindu scripture, the Bhagavad Gita, were spoken on July 16, 1945, by J. Robert Oppenheimer, as the first successful test of an atomic bomb took place in the desert of New Mexico. Right before World War II, in 1938 Germany, two scientists, Otto Hahn and Fritz Strassmann, discovered that bombarding uranium with neutrons creates a different element, barium. At the time, they had no explanation why this was occurring, but a friend, physicist Lisa Meitner, realizes they had split the nucleus of the uranium atom, a process which she called fission. Meitner publishes her conclusion in the scientific journal Nature, and the news starts circulating in the physics community. By applying Einstein's equation, E equals mc squared, every physicist on the planet now knows that an atomic bomb could be built. In the United States, physicists are horrified. What if Hitler is building the bomb right now? After all, the discovery was made in Germany by German scientists. To Leo Szilard, a nuclear physicist from California, this possibility is unthinkable and cannot be allowed to happen. But at that time, no one in the US government understood the terrible danger the world would soon face. How could they understand the danger of a device that doesn't yet exist? Szilard is convinced that the only way to stop Hitler from obtaining the atomic bomb was for the United States to create it first. He writes a letter to President Franklin Roosevelt and asks Albert Einstein to co-sign it in the hopes that his notoriety would help get Roosevelt's attention. This works. A small but decisive step is achieved. Roosevelt greenlights a uranium research initiative, but nothing more. Little did he know that this seemingly innocent scientific endeavor would soon transform into a race against time. December 7th, 1941. The Japanese launch a devastating attack on Pearl Harbor, and Hitler declares war on the United States. America finds itself entangled in two formidable conflicts, one against Germany in Europe, and the other against Japan in the Pacific. Suddenly, Roosevelt's uranium research project becomes critically important. What began as scientific inquiry is about to become a crash program to build a theoretical bomb. The largest government scientific project in history begins to take shape under the codename Manhattan. The man in charge of the project was General Leslie Groves, a skilled military man. In just 2 months, Groves sets in place the foundation for what would be the largest industrial endeavor in history. He builds factories, roads, and a uranium refining facility. Groves knows that uranium without a device to set it off is useless, so he goes on a tour of the most prestigious universities in search of scientists to build his bomb. He meets several great minds, but Groves is a tough, no-nonsense military man, and this is a clash of cultures. Groves finds the PhDs to be very undisciplined. There's an issue of excessive chatter and lack of concern for security. This project demands utmost secrecy. Worst of all, most of them are condescending towards Groves, since he didn't have a PhD, and this he cannot stand. He knows he could never work with them. General Groves needs a scientist to lead them, someone he can work with, and who can manage a team of the most brilliant, but also cantankerous minds ever assembled in one place. Groves's choice ultimately falls on one man, J. Robert Oppenheimer, a man who knew physics, but had no administrative experience besides running small graduate seminars. However, General Groves saw in Oppenheimer a man who understood the gravity of the situation and what was at stake. The uranium required to make the bomb was mined in Canada, Colorado, and in the Congo. The raw material, in the form of uranium-238, was brought to Oak Ridge, Tennessee, where several refinement plants were built, and where it would be enriched into uranium-235. Oppenheimer and the rest of the physicists were moved to the remote base of Los Alamos in the New Mexico desert, where they worked tirelessly around the clock, building the device which would set off the nuclear chain reaction and create the largest man-made explosion in history. By the beginning of 1944, a design was finally achieved. Two chunks of uranium-235 will be slammed together, creating a critical mass and a nuclear explosion. It is a simple yet fail-safe design, but a problem remained. At this point, Oppenheimer's team still didn't have enough fuel for a viable atomic bomb. The process of making uranium-235 from uranium-238 was painstakingly slow. At the rate the wars in Europe and in the Pacific were escalating, the material wouldn't be ready in time to change what seemed a bleak outcome for the Allies. Oppenheimer needed a new fission material, something he could produce faster and in greater quantity. They turned towards plutonium, an element which is much faster to produce and could be the key to making multiple bombs. But when physicist Emilio Segre gets the first tiny sample of plutonium, he makes a devastating discovery. Their bomb design is incompatible with plutonium, which will cause the device to melt, not explode. Oppenheimer is devastated. They would have to start the design process, which took years to complete, all over again, and time was running out. It's summer 1944. The Allies have invaded France, but the outcome is still in doubt. The Germans are introducing frightening new weapons, the world's first jet fighter, a cruise missile, and a supersonic rocket. From the looks of it, their scientists are hard at work, and they could be close to building an atomic bomb. The war could be lost if Germany got the bomb first. In Los Alamos, Oppenheimer takes a different approach, a possible way to use plutonium. An uranium nuclear explosion is achieved by slamming two elements together with enough power to create a chain reaction, but plutonium needs to be compressed in order to explode. The laboratory is reorganized, and chemist George Kistiakowsky from Harvard is brought in to work on the project. As complex and daunting as implosion is, Kistiakowsky and his small team will not be nearly enough. They turn to the British, who send some of their scientists to Los Alamos. General Groves wanted all of them vetted for possible security risks, but he was reassured by his superiors that the scientists were trustworthy. Among the new arrivals was a quiet and strange refugee from Germany. His name was Klaus Fuchs. He was a very good physicist. He made interesting suggestions, very cooperative, but a sort of an odd character, and he made some of the other scientists uncomfortable. Besides being brilliant and odd, Klaus Fuchs was secretly a dedicated communist. In a few short years, his presence at Los Alamos will come to haunt Groves and Oppenheimer. By early 1945, the war in Europe was in its final months. Germany was squeezed between Americans, British and French on the west, and by the Soviets on the east. In Los Alamos, the device for the uranium bomb is ready to go. All that's missing is the uranium, but there should be enough for one bomb by summer. As for a plutonium bomb, they are still working on implosion. In May, Germany surrenders. The war in Europe is over. Hitler and the fear of a Nazi atomic bomb, the very things that gave birth to the Manhattan Project, are now gone. But in the Pacific, the war against Japan is still raging. At Los Alamos, the job had to be finished. Finally, a device using plutonium is ready. It is nicknamed the Gadget. It is a 6-foot sphere filled with batteries, electronics, and explosives. At its center, a ball of plutonium, the core. If this device works, the world will never be the same. The bomb is hoisted to the top of a 100-foot steel tower. The last crucial piece, the grapefruit-sized plutonium core, is carefully put in place. The clock ticks. The test is set to take place at 5:30 a.m. Everyone is nervous. The clock counts down. 10, 9, 8, 7. This is the Trinity test. 4, 3, 2, 1. The expanding ball of fire looked like an inferno reaching for the heavens. The heat was intense, even from a considerable distance. All stood in awe of the raw power humanity had harnessed. The Trinity atomic test had succeeded in its objective, proving that the atomic bomb was a viable weapon of mass destruction. August 1945. The uranium bomb, called Little Boy, is now ready for deployment. Despite never undergoing a test, Oppenheimer is confident in its simplicity and effectiveness. The bomb is securely loaded aboard the B-29 Enola Gay. Just before dawn on August 6th, the plane embarks on its mission. covering a distance of 1,500 miles throughout the night. At precisely 8:15 a.m. over Hiroshima, the bomb is released. Upon detonation, an enormous fireball measuring a quarter mile in diameter generates temperatures of up to 10,000 degrees. Anything within close proximity to the epicenter is instantaneously vaporized. Subsequently, a powerful shockwave erupts, obliterating everything in its path. An area spanning nearly a mile in all directions is utterly devastated, leaving only a few concrete structures intact. In places where objects or individuals absorb the intense heat, haunting shadows remain. Tragically, at least 80,000 people lose their lives. But even after this, the Japanese will not surrender. The shock of the first bomb didn't quite do it. The Americans decide it is time to end this war once and for all. On August 9th, another B-29 bomber, carrying the Fat Man plutonium bomb, takes off. The target is Kokura, but Kokura is obscured by clouds. Because of this, thousands of people are spared, but others will die in their place. The plane heads for the backup target. The second city hit by an atomic bomb will be Nagasaki. One day later, Japan capitulates, putting an end to World War II. The triumph of the bomb, winning the war with science, seems the perfect American success story. At the time, the atomic bomb was acclaimed, with many certain the way to stop all wars was finally found. But as time went on, some started to worry the Russians would now get an atomic bomb, and a deadly weapons race would begin between Russia and the US. Little did they know, it was already too late. Klaus Fuchs, the odd scientist brought in to work on the plutonium bomb, was a Russian spy. So was another American scientist, a Harvard-educated man named Ted Hall. They were both funneling top-secret information to the communists in Russia. For Stalin, the weapons race had started the minute he saw the pictures from Hiroshima, when the possibilities of this new weapon became clear. So ensued the Cold War. If you enjoyed this video, leave a like to support my work, subscribe to my channel, and check out these other interesting videos.